Buckley scored the most startling political upset in the nation last fall when the voters of New York sent him to the Senate of the United States on the Conservative Party ticket, the closest historical precedent being the election in Dublin 20 years ago of a Jewish mayor. The Conservative Party of New York was then only 8 years old, and the notion that it would ever prosper in the liberal soil of New York was held to be either romantic or perverse. But the notion that it would ever germinate a United States senator was held to be otherworldly, so that the election in question tells us a great deal about New York that we didn't know, and perhaps a certain amount about Senator Buckley that we didn't know, or perhaps more accurately, that you didn't know. My brother was born in New York in 1923. He attended schools in France and England. He graduated from the Millbrook School in Millbrook, New York, and then from Yale University, where he majored in English literature, served on the College Daily as a columnist, and maintained a pet boa constrictor who accompanied him to select classes. He then joined the Navy and was in active duty aboard an LST for over 3 years in the Pacific as Lieutenant JG. After the war, he attended Yale Law School, practiced in New Haven, Connecticut, and went into business in New York City. He managed my campaign for mayor in 1965 and ran as an independent against Senator Javits in 1968. Senator Buckley is listed as a, quote, conservative hyphen republic. We're here to discuss the problems of a small c conservative legislator. I would like to begin by asking him whether there is a particular hostility in Congress to someone who adheres to his positions.
None that I've been able to see, not in the Senate anyway. And of course, I'm only familiar with what goes on in the Senate, and not that familiar yet, as I've only been there 6 months. But no, I've had a very fine welcome, and I do find there are an awful lot of people around who think as I do, although not quite enough of them, obviously.
Well, is there in Congress a feeling that you belong either to the in-liberal group or that you belong to the sort of a troglodytic other group or the nuances such that there is an elision between the one group and the other?
There's a broad spectrum. You start, there is a group that is about as liberal as you can find. There are others that are about as conservative as you can find, and you can find your spot somewhere in that spectrum. I think I am regarded still a little bit as a curiosity, but I'm sort of feeling my way around. I'm finding my place, not being put in my place, I might add. I think I'm just accepted as a member of the team, and there is no hostility, no curiosity, or anything else at this stage.
Well, would as much be said about somebody coming in from anywhere? For instance, would Bella Abzug and Senator Bilbo have no difficulty at all doing business together in Congress?
Well,
are they that cosmopolitan?
It's a pretty cosmopolitan group, but one of the Senate has a very interesting air of total civility, so that I think that if you aren't more or less apt to be naturally civil, something about the atmosphere that causes you to abide by the ground rules in the sense of not going out and hurling insults or using the wrong kind of language. So I think there's a real tolerance to difference of points of view in the Senate that it makes the Senate function rather well, I think.
What about how does one as a freshman and especially as a conservative senator, how does one get the feel of one's constituency? You are a conservative, you represent a liberal state. Do people typically write and say, I supported you and therefore I want you to do something? Or do they say, support you, but I nevertheless want you to do something?
In spite of the fact that I voted against you and think you represent everything I don't believe in, nevertheless I've got a problem here and you happen to be in the spot, therefore you address yourself to it. There's some of that, and there's some of the other in terms of, as I worked hard for you, you owe me something. But mainly the letters are expressing just concerns on issues. And as you are one of two people within the Senate who is in a position to perhaps do something about this issue or that, they want either your reaction or advise you how to vote. Of course, you have very energetic groups on all sides of the political spectrum that'll make the journey to Washington. And one of the problems and or delights, whichever way you want to look at it, of representing a state the size of New York and as available as New York is you get an awful lot of people coming by.
Well, is it generally assumed in the Senate that if you're a senator from, say, New York or California, I guess would be the only other state where this would follow, that you wield a special clout in the light of the amount of federal money that's spent in your home state, and especially in the case of New York, in the light of the fact that it is the acknowledged center of the that it is the communications capital of the world?
There's some of that, undoubtedly. I think there's more public interest. Now, by public, I don't mean just the public in your own state. I think there's more national interest in a senator from a very large state than there would be for one from a smaller one. And to that extent, I suppose I've had more than my share of the press. I don't think that the fact that New York is, quotes, the communication center of the world as such, singles me out. It seems to me that a fellow called John Tunney has had a certain amount of publicity in recent months, and I think that is a result of the size of his constituency and of the important interests. I think this is a more significant. New York State has within it many important international interest banks, the stock exchange, institutions, and therefore the views of the senator of that particular state in reference to the problems of these institutions in itself is kind of newsworthy.
Well, have you found that the press is available as a means through of communicating your views to your constituency and to other people whose views, to whom you desire to communicate?
Let's put it this way. I don't think it's a two-way street. The press is often interested in what my views might be on something or another, and then this will get asked about and get communicated. Now, on the other side of the equation, there's a problem of wanting very much to communicate a point of view, to let the public at large know that there's the other side of the question, for example. And this becomes more difficult, because if you're a very junior senator at the bottom of the totem pole, you don't have much clout within the Senate beyond that 1% that you represent, unless you happen to be on a particularly strategic committee. And the more strategic committees take a little while to get on. I have had a couple of experiences where I think, where I felt that I had something to say, where I wanted very badly to get it out. And apparently the managing editor or the city editor didn't think it was as newsworthy as I did.
In which case, he treats you like anybody else. Huh?
I'm afraid so, yes. It's very humiliating. It's,
constitutional?
Right.
What about people have raised the point that you became a senator using very unconventional procedures. There was a third party founded, and that third party won for the first time in, 25 years or something like that, 30, 40 years?
First time since 1940.
Since 1940. Now, Are you in a position to encourage other people who feel that neither of their parties satisfies them to proceed to found a third party?
Not necessarily. I think it depends on the particular state and on whether or not the two-party system in that state is able to function as such. New York, it was a very special situation. There had been in existence since the end of the Second World War a liberal party that developed an enormous amount of clout because it was able to command a swing vote, and they were able routinely to get the money to produce the candidates and so on. So they had a cherry to dangle in front of either Democrats or liberals, which had the effect in New York state politics of causing both parties to gravitate to the left and to fuzz the distinctions that ought to exist at some point between two parties in a two-party system. But at the same time, New York State did not have a meaningful law for the primaries. Therefore, you couldn't work within the system to, in effect, make a point of view within a party felt. So the founders of the Conservative Party, who I think by and large were mostly Republicans, feel the necessity to found the Conservative Party to restore the balance in New York State, and they've done a very good job. Now, if you get into other states, the first question you'd want to ask is whether or not a dissident group or a group that feels that a legitimate point of view within the party spectrum is not being adequately represented, can they work through the primary system? And this is certainly the route that I would like to see them follow, because I believe strongly in a two-party system, because I think it provides for stability. Each point of view, each of the responsible alternatives, must be somewhat broad in order to embrace all the people who want to exercise their franchise. But if the parties become insensitive to a very significant point of view within the traditional range of viewpoints represented by that party, then they do invite the formation of third parties.
Well, as a matter of ideological opportunism, you admit that the Liberal Party was smart to have founded itself, right?
I.e., they dominated. Smart leadership anyway.
What's that?
It had smart leadership, able leadership.
It had smart leadership, and it had a good idea. That is to say, by becoming a pressure party in New York State, I understand you to say, they exercised over a period of 20, 25 years, leverage not only over the Democratic Party, but over the Republican Party. They attracted Democrats over there, and in due course, the Republicans, in pursuit of those Democrats, traveled in the same direction, right?
That is correct.
Well, why wouldn't the Conservative Party take the same initiative in other states?
I think one further fact about the Liberal Party needs to be known in order to get the full picture, and that is that it was basically the creature of a couple of unions in New York City, which had the organizational continuity and so on, plus the hypnosis that is seemed to be emanate from people who were known as union bosses, to be able to project a presence that might not naturally survive in other political situations. Because to form and maintain a party takes an awful lot of work. You have to duplicate all the machinery at the county level and so on. There's paperwork that is burdensome and so on. Now, to the extent, in the normal situation, that the parties respond to the stimulus of this dissident group, to that extent, that will the incentives for keeping that group alive disappear. In other words, I think there would be a withering away. There would have been a withering away in the situation of New York City if it hadn't been for the strong leadership and continuity and the mechanism of two unions behind it.
Of the two unions.
Yes.
Well, if you take a state like California, would you say that it would be to the personal ideological advantage of the left wing in the state of California to organize a third party, patterned, let's say, after the Liberal Party, in order to take the Republican Party and force it to move to the left of its existing position?
Not necessarily, because it depends, among other things, on the plausibility of what it has to deliver. And it also runs the risk, in the interim, of so dividing the vote closest to its ideals, so as to encourage the other guys, by definition in any of these contexts, the bad guys, to win. Mm-hmm. So that there is a risk involved in this situation which I don't know would be attractive.
Uh-huh. Well,
let's put it this way, there has to be a willingness to punish in order for these movements to be effective.
Mm-hmm. Maybe they ought to try it in California, what do you think?
Well, I don't know.
What do you think of the conservative parties that have been started in Michigan and Massachusetts? Do they follow any of the criteria that you've described?
I frankly don't know enough about the inside mechanics there to make a judgment, frankly. I know that the Republican system in Massachusetts has got a primary, rather the election system has a primary mechanism, and it had been tried during the senatorial campaign last year, when the nominee of the party was challenged, and the challenger came pretty close to upsetting him. It seems to me that there's a situation there which invites further challenge. Now, on the other hand, I have no idea whether or not the people who are in charge of the party mechanism, the bosses so-called, have proved themselves so insensitive to that very large group that feels itself unrepresented that they are forcing the formation of a third party. I just don't know. Michigan, I don't know the facts.
You're talking about Massachusetts.
Massachusetts.
Yeah. I see. Well, the formation of a third party in a two party situation tends to suggest, does it not, that there is either a breakdown in communication between the existing parties and the people, or that three distinct points of view crop up, right?
That's correct.
Now, what would be a third point of view as regards some of the major issues of the day, or do you think that they would all succumb under the force of definitional stress into two points of view?
Not necessarily.
Vietnam, there would be three points of view.
Right. And in other ways, there is a group, let's just use the word New Left, which says the whole system is lousy, whether it's called Democratic or Republican. We want to tear everything down and restructure the country and its institutions. One of the dangers we may be moving into in this country is that we are maybe walking away for the first time in our national history from a general consensus as to what is good, or what are the ideals, what are the values, what are the norms. And I think that if we have that strong consensus, if the society of civilization has that strong consensus, then as to any issue, as to any problem, there are apt to be basically two points of view, two alternatives. But if you start questioning the very premise on which, say, the Constitution is founded, if you start saying that representative government, for example, is no good, or that the institutions of private property are a blasphemy on the human race, then you are introducing some new elements into the political structure which make the two-party system impossible to cope with this new situation. Then you start getting a fracturing, and then you start getting, I'm afraid, perhaps chaos.
What is the attitude of the typical conservative legislator towards Mr. Nixon these days?
It depends on which one you speak to. There is a wide range of feeling. I believe that most of them, on the whole, and I'm talking now of the ones in Washington, obviously, feel that he has done some tremendously innovative things, that he has correctly analyze the fact that we are suffering from too much government, not enough government. His whole emphasis in the State of the Union message about reversing the historic flow of power to Washington as being the prime necessity if we're going to restore any kind of effectiveness in government in handling our situation. Now, this I think has been, in my estimation anyway, the central theme song of conservatives for the last 20 or 30 years since we started concentrating all that power in Washington. And therefore, any conservative can only applaud his attempt to, for example, under the special revenue sharing programs, to collapse about 105 existing programs, sure, continue the flow of money. I like to think of this as a more of an interim rather than a final institutionalized flow. But at least you're removing the ability of bureaucrats in Washington to tell communities and so on how to handle their problems, not Washington's problems. Now, in other areas, there is real question. The fiscal area is one of the principal ones. This whole business of the full employment budget concept. When I first heard that phrase...
Yeah, is that a phony or is it not a phony?
It's not. At first I wondered if it was just a sugarcoating for deficit financing and inflationary... the financing of the deficit. And so I inquired around, and among the people I inquired of is a fellow called Milton Friedman. And he said, no, that is not a phony. It's a sound concept. In fact, I had something to do with its development back in the 40s or 50s. But it's a sound concept, however, only if the inherent disciplines are observed.
Only if you stash it away when there's a surplus.
That's part of it, but not all of it. What the full employment concept recognizes is that there are cycles, and that you ought not necessarily stop functioning just because. Let's assume that all of your revenue was income tax revenue, and that all of your companies only corporate, and that there came a point where all of your corporations were fully operating, but none of them made a profit. Under that set of circumstances, your government would have zero revenue, yet it would have to operate certain essential services. So you borrow. But the disciplines are that under that concept, as you are working with a gap in your productive capacity to the stimulus that comes from the borrowing is not overcrowding that productive capacity to the point we start causing inflation. By the same token, you must have the discipline not to take your IOUs financing this interim deficit and put them into the banking system with the inevitable inflationary effect. there is another problem, and that is a psychological one, that once you get away from that discipline of there being on the red side or the black side of the ledger, then people tend to lose their sense of perspective, as we have seen in the Congress. The president was saying, it is okay, he proposed a budget with an inbuilt deficit, but he then said, we've got to hold it at that line. Now, the Congress is voting all kinds of legislation that is forcing it way beyond that limit. I'm not satisfied that would necessarily have had greater self-discipline if we were looking at a budget in the black. Now, however, let me go a step beyond that. I think quite clearly the president has gone beyond his own guidelines here. We have expanded the money supply at a very large rate, although technically that's not his responsibility. It's the Federal Reserve Bank. But no one has heard him complaining about this. We know that he has introduced some programs that go beyond those limits. He hasn't revised the budgetary goals in the light of the fact that revenue is not coming in at the rate anticipated, or the economy is not growing at the rate anticipated. And to the extent that he is going beyond this point, I think all conservatives are concerned.
Well, under this new terminology,
what happens to the conservative critique of Roosevelt, for instance, as a deficit spender? Certainly the size of the deficit under the New Deal never exceeded what the revenues would have brought into the government if an additional 20 million people had been employed, right? So right. Do we all of a sudden under the new dispensation think of Roosevelt as having been a very conservative administrator of the
Not
money?
Necessarily. First of all, I'm not frankly sufficiently apprised of the details of what he did to know whether or not what he did would have fit within the concept of full employment economy, including the disciplines on how you borrow your money.
Well, let me tell you this. He never overspent by a sum of money greater than would have been generated if they had been full employment.
That is true. Mm-hmm. On the other hand,
Keynesians, of course, criticized him precisely for not having primed the pump.
He might have been a prophet before his time.
Yeah.
Now, I do think that we may need to re-examine some of the traditional conservative sloganeering in the light of the kind of analysis that was put into this full employment concept. However, keeping in the black or in the red is a handy ground rule to hang on to, and one that I would prefer to do. Of course, the critique against Franklin D. Roosevelt was not limited to matters of deficit spending. It had to do about putting in all kinds of programs that were intended to help people and ended up not really helping them.
Yes, but don't you agree that it is a part of the conservative responsibility, to the extent that it understands itself to be talking about the politics of realities, to precisely consult history and advise people and yourself that certain kinds of self-discipline typically aren't possible? Wouldn't we agree that a doctor was irresponsible if he said to you, it's okay to take a shot of heroin once a month? Because what we do know about human nature is enough to know that if you were given a shot of heroin once a month, you'd become an addict after a few months. By the same token, don't we know enough about democratic habits and about history in general to know that if we encourage deficit spending by whatever name, we precisely aren't going to show the kind of discipline with which it is always presented as desirable?
Now, I think the job of conservative thinkers or conservative leaders is to be willing to re-examine their own premises in the light of new knowledge, so as to make sure we're always in touch with reality. It doesn't shock me to examine this idea of deficit financing within the concept of full employment, if it is in fact sound. And then say we should no longer grow into despair if we go beyond that bounds, but let's make sure that we have that discipline. Now, in point of fact, the political realities are such that until you have enough conservatives in the Congress, or until you have a Congress controlled by the same party as the administration, they're not going to be working in tandem. So that even if the president had proposed a nicely balanced budget, you'd still have the same impulse, I'm afraid, in today's world to go heavily into the red. In this whole area, I think that one of the reasons why in the past conservative thinking was discredited was that it became ossified out of certain habits and rituals, and that one of the great contributions, for example, of a journal called National Review has been that it has brought fresh insights and fresh analysis and interpreted these old verities in the context of our present
problems. Well, I'm all for fresh insights, especially those I midwife. But I am saying this, that funny money, as they used to call it, is something that everybody likes to play at, because for one thing, it's easiest. Now, all of a sudden, everything that we were taught about deficit spending, we are supposed to have been untaught overnight. It's like the socialization of railroads. I didn't even notice that it happened until all of a sudden I found myself riding in one. But all of a sudden, we found Mr. Nixon trotting along, spending $25-30 billion more than he is taking in, and it seems to be there's no hue and cry. Yeah,
I think I will have to say this: he's not spending 25 or 30 billion more than he's taking in, because a portion of that is spending that he never approved of. But he was spending an awful lot more money than he anticipated becoming in. But to get to your point,
well, say Congress.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think the Congress has yet to learn the fiscal lessons we need to know, if we're going to achieve that stability of growth on which our long-range health is dependent, and if we're going to bring back that stability of the value of the dollar, which at the present time is cruel to the most defenseless people in our society, namely those too old to work.
So a conversation between you and Milton Friedman repealed the conservative bias against deficit spending is that insight.
Let's put it this way, that there are theoretical considerations and there are prudential ones.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I'm not sure that I would hate anyone in your audience to believe that Milton Friedman necessarily endorses the Nixon administration's fiscal policies.
Yeah.
Because I'm sure he does not. But I do say that he has assured me and presented arguments, evidence, and the rest of it, that it is not inappropriate to have this larger cycle in which you, in effect, balance your books. But he did point out the dangers, the great dangers, A, of misforecasting, and the other great danger of just losing your sense of discipline.
You know what my insight is? That I think conservative governors, let's call Nixon a conservative in this sense, are finding something which Democrats are also discovering, that it's really cheaper to have welfare via the private sector. By that I mean that they realize that by, let's say, lending money to Lockheed, they're not really engaged in producing airplanes, they're engaged in employing a lot of people. By making some sort of an agreement with Japan having to do with limiting the imports of textiles, we're not really engaged in protection for the sake of the great entrepreneurs, but we are engaged in relieving ourselves of the problem of looking after 100,000 people who would otherwise find themselves in relief.
Of course, that's arguable.
May this not be the direction of the new economics, to use deficit spending as a way of coping more efficiently with what otherwise would be an unemployment problem?
It is in part that, but I'm not sure that I would utilize that Lockheed example, because I think conservatives are also very leery of creating having a reaction to a particular situation which will establish a precedent that will be applied to all kinds of other situations ad nauseum.
In fact, Nixon wants us to bail out. They use the term bail out Lockheed. Now, I grant this is what he wants, but I don't think he's doing it for the stockholders. At least I can't understand. The stockholders own $200 million worth of raw assets, and their stock is priced at $100 million, so they double their money if they liquidate it right now. It's the 35,000 people that Nixon doesn't want to go out of work in California that is causing him, isn't it, primarily, to sponsor that legislation?
That is a very real concern. Whether it is a concern that is an appropriate one is something entirely different. Mm-hmm. Will these people really go out of work? Let's assume you had an orderly proceedings
the short run is 1972.
Not necessarily. Because you have a profitable operating entities, which I'm sure other industries and so on would be happy to purchase, to acquire.
But there are a lot of unemployed people in California
right now. Now, any upset of a particular situation, business, whether it be shoelace manufacturing or whatever, will have a highly localized effect. But if you're talking about the overall effect on the country, this is not necessarily so. Lockheed goes out of business, what suffers is this TriStar of Airbus or whatever it's called. Now, to the extent that Lockheed isn't producing the aircraft needed to meet that particular market demand, then other American airframe manufacturers will. And as those others, incidentally, are utilizing American engines, that perhaps having this particular program go out of business would help overall employment in the United States. I'm saying that hypothetically.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mr. Clement.
For a moment, I'd like to get back to the idea of third parties. You stressed your support of the two-party system and also quite succinctly covered why you saw the necessity of a third party in New York.
Sometimes elsewhere in the country.
Okay. In 1968, there was a great deal of discussion in the general media concerning the third-party scare of the American Independent Party, the idea that if George Wallace got enough votes, that the Electoral College would be thrown into panic, the election would be thrown into the House of Representatives, and that the country could possibly be thrown into chaos. There was a lot of discussion about this. It didn't happen, fortunately. But now we see a new party rising. Your own election shows some strength in this party.
It's a state party.
Okay, but your brother mentioned two other conservative parties.
Having no
elsewhere.
Connection whatsoever. Yeah.
In the future, possibly. Yeah. They might elect candidates. They might even run a presidential candidate. Right. What happens is you can extrapolate more parties, more splintering.
I hope not, because I think it'll be a very bad thing for the country. But I'm not ruling out by any means a natural evolution if the existing two-party structure doesn't provide its historic function, which is to provide people with meaningful, identifiable alternatives. If two parties in a given state habitually, year in and year out, offer candidates that are so indistinguishable one from the other that a whole section of your population just feels disenfranchised, they're going to do something about it. I might remind you that ours has been a two-party system from the beginning, but we have historically had third parties coming in which ultimately become that other party because they've had a fresh viewpoint to represent. Now, one of the things that my election clearly demonstrated in New York is that a tremendous section of the New York sentiment, the New York voter, had been disenfranchised over a long period of year in most of your statewide elections. And incidentally, I believe it's a majority sentiment because any analysis of the vote that Charles Goodell got demonstrated that the majority of the votes he ended up with came from intense Republican loyalists who just couldn't conceive of voting any other way than their grandfathers had voted, so that in a runoff, I would have been the majority candidate. Man.
We do have difficulty passing legislation now with two parties, though.
I'm not for the third-party system, but I'm saying that it may be necessary in this instance or that for a third party to come into existence in order to once again offer healthy alternatives, the viable alternatives. And in terms of the Electoral College, incidentally, one of the reasons that I am for the maintenance of an electoral system, even though maybe once every 180 years you might have to go to the House of Representatives, is that it makes more difficult the establishment of a meaningful third party nationally.
The AIP doesn't appear to be having any problems, although it did not do as well in 68 as was expected. It's still around, and I'm sure George Wallace will be running in 72 again.
That's speculation.
Ms. King.
I was wondering, on the Lockheed issue, I think you suggested that perhaps this is the direction of the new economy or economic theories, to filter government money through private industry in order to provide jobs or to ward off unemployment. And if I understand you right, you don't think that's necessarily a good direction to take. Do you think that government should be in the business of directly providing jobs at all?
No, I was just... Yes, those jobs that require involving government services. Beyond that, no. No, I just was worried about his use of the Lockheed as an example. Syndrome. Let's take something else. Let us talk about housing, for example, as an area where I think we have learned things generally in terms of, just as a result of experience, and that is that when the government itself gets into the housing business, take your urban renewal programs, which have had the effect of destroying more units than they have created and contributing heavily to the congestions of our inner cities and so on, or take the public housing units, which just plain haven't worked satisfactorily. I think it's now occurring to people that what you ought to do is not subsidize the housing, but subsidize that person whose earning power or abilities, if he's too old or blind and so on, subsidize his ability to get housing. Then he will go into the marketplace and use, you might say, his rent chit or whatever to secure the housing that is required. But then you don't have the federal government moving into and in effect socializing one of your industries.
Then the federal monies or whatever governmental body would be providing the funds should go directly to the individual rather than filtering it through an industry.
In the instance of housing and things of that sort, I believe so very strongly, yes. In terms of, I don't believe in the federal government subsidizing industries. I do believe in the federal government, under the most extraordinary situations, protecting an industry if our national security is dependent on it. And there's some oddball ones around. There is a ball bearing industry, for example, that's about to disappear from this country, on which our military depend.
Do you want to do something about it?
Others are worrying about it.
Ms. Murphy?
I'd like to know what programs the Conservative Party enacting that would bring interest into your party, the 18 and 20-year-old votes.
18 and 21? I will say this, because the Conservative Party as such is a New York State operation, and its recommendations and so on have been largely at the state level. I had more people, 18 to 21, working enthusiastically in my campaign than my two opponents, the official candidates of the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, themselves had. I think that there is an awareness among younger people of the extent to which government as such is getting too large and is smothering lives, smothering them in red tape and so on, so that there is a being which is being repressive, whittling away at their freedoms, so that there on all kinds of campuses around the country, I know there are active cells, if you want to call it, of a fine conservative intellectual thinking. But there, I will cite my own example as one where there was a real enthusiasm. I had more than 5,000 people, college and high school ages, manning posts all over the state. I believe that anything which is founded on reality, anything that's going to open up the opportunities of an individual, anything which is going to give each person the greater opportunity to express his own individuality and achieve his own goals, is going to be ultimately attractive. We've had a lot of promises thrown around this country by the liberals for many, many years, but we've only had enough historical experience with them to find out that they're bankrupt, that they just don't work. And so young people are searching for new alternatives. Now, some of these alternatives are very radical in, you might say, the socialized Marxist sense, and others are searching back to the old truisms, you might say, that are reflected in conservative thought.
If this is the case,
I'm getting paid for this.
If this is the case, then why would you? What would be the reasoning for in California, the registering of the 18 and 20-year-old votes at 5-1 Democrat?
Let me ask you this statistic: what percentage of the 18 to 20 through 20-year-old vote has registered?
No statistics, I guess.
My understanding is that it's a very small percentage of the total potential group. And that you do have one thing the Democrats have always had has been a tremendous sort of organizational strength, and they sort of get each other out and mobilize. But in terms of I don't think this necessarily reflects sentiment. I don't know, of course, about California, which I assume is not all that different from the other states. But I do know that one senator told me 2 days ago that he had just had a poll of his state, which is a large one, one of the larger than medium, that has a wide variety of interest in terms of industrial agriculture and so on, and that 18 through 20 sentiment differed from the 21 above by one percentile.
Well, you do concede. I think Mr. Murphy is right in his general assumption that the majority of the newly enfranchised voters are going to vote for the Democratic Party.
They might, yes, they might, but it doesn't necessarily mean that that vote will be representative of youth sentiment. There's an awful lot of laziness around among old people and young people.
Well, there's an awful lot of ignorance around.
Well, that's why you and I are here.
Age brackets in general.
Well, according to our fair governor, Governor Reagan, he said that the federal government has been controlled by, let's say, the Democrats for the last 39 years. It would seem to me that if the Conservative Party was, you know, would come into being as a nationwide thing, that this would take votes and separate the conservatives and the starch Republicans. Therefore, would cause the Democrats to really take over control.
That doesn't follow necessarily. There's a tremendous conservative sentiment within the Democratic Party, within ranks of traditional Democrats, who feel increasingly unhappy about the leadership of their party. And in point of fact, I received 40% of my actual vote from Democrats. So that I believe that there is a certain intuitive understanding of what is common sense. And that if, and I like to think that conservative wisdom is rooted in human experience, therefore commonsensical. Okay. So that I think that, first of all, I don't think you're going to see a conservative party come in nationally, but you may see pressures which will cause one party or the other to more closely identify itself with this point of view or that point of view. And actually nationally, the Republican Party is pretty conservative.
I'd like to ask you one last question. I don't know very much about your campaign and what you did when, but from what I've been able to pick up, if it had just been one liberal run against you, wouldn't you have lost? Instead
I don't see
of two.
Why?
Didn't the liberals split the votes, causing you to win the campaign?
No, the Liberal Party endorsed my Republican candidate, my opponent. So you had the liberal vote going to Charles Goodell, although most of it actually went to Ottinger, and so it was a three-way. It was a genuine three-way race.
You know, I think Mr. Murphy is saying is using the word liberal, meaning of people who are liberal, not the Liberal Party.
Oh, excuse me. No.
In which case, you must come through with the Goodell analysis.
Well, I had stated that the analysis that has been made of Mr. Goodell's vote indicated that over half of his support came from the most...
Would have gone to you if you had
Would have gone it. To me, yes, mm-hmm. because it came from Republican loyalists, mostly in upstate New York, which is the least liberal part of the state.
In other words, if it had been just two guys, he thinks he would have won. Mr. Clement.
Senator Buckley, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe you recently spoke out in favor of increased strategic armaments
right.
to match proportional increases by the Russians. And I've heard you here this evening speak out against deficit spending. Mm-hmm. Now, we already have enough overkill in this country to, I believe, provide 10,000 tons of TNT for every person living on the surface of the earth.
You obviously didn't read my speech, or you would know that the fact that we have it doesn't do us any good if 90% of it is destroyed in a first strike.
Why spend this type of money if you're opposed to deficit spending? We're already spending $80 billion a year on defense.
First, you've asked a question that requires whole layers of answers, but let's say this, that historically at least, every society has considered its own survival to be its primary priority. That if we don't continue to exist, we can't do anything. Now, the cost of armament, which nobody likes, is not something that is done because of fancy or because of a desire to get increasingly sophisticated hardware or to keep the aerospace industry going, but is if you are not a country which seeks to dominate others, which is not aggressive, it is a response to the military needs imposed on you by the power of your potential enemies. Now, what has happened in the last 5-6 years is really extraordinary and not yet appreciated by the American public at large or by most legislators yet. And that is that the Soviet Union, while we have leveled off and while in fact our conventional forces have deteriorated in real strength, the Russians have been on a all-out effort in every category which now, for the first time, places in the U.S. in a situation where we could have our deterrent capacity, which has been the ultimate instrument of trying to maintain peace in this world, destroyed so it is no longer credible. In other words, we do not have, although we have the bombs in being, we will be stripped of the ability to deliver them. Therefore, we will not have a deterrent capacity. Therefore, the underpinnings of the so-called atomic umbrella and so on, which has made possible our series of alliances in NATO, for example, our foreign policy in the Middle East, viable. Now, in other areas, take our Sixth Fleet. At one time, we had total supremacy in the Mediterranean. And this, in turn, meant that we ultimately had the power close at hand to back up our policy of telling the Russians, don't you get involved actively in Arab-Israeli hostilities. We are pretty close to the line now on having been stripped of that power, because the Russians now have more people in more ships in the Mediterranean than we have, and she has aircraft now flying and deployed in Egypt and Libya, which we don't have a single aircraft to match. In other words, we have been outstripped. So if this requires deficit financing, if we have to go in the red for our own survival, then this is the kind of thing we have to do. There is an alternative, and that is to tax ourselves more, and that is to, in effect, to take our standard of living down a couple of notches. There is a third possibility, and that is to divert money from some programs which some of us feel aren't achieving any good, and concentrate them here, which is not a matter of choice but a necessity, as I see it.
Well, some of us also feel that other programs are not achieving any good. Does your conclusion then presuppose the demise of the SALT talks? If you're calling for armaments at a time when our negotiators are attempting to eliminate
I believe that the one hope and the only hope that the SALT talks will come up with something that is truly mutually fair, that is not, an agreement that is not to the disadvantage of the United States, is if the Russians are satisfied that we have woken up and are beginning to catch up on this imbalance. Now, let me tell you this. Anytime we talk about stationing an ABM or something of that sort, somebody in Russia says, ooh, you're going to sabotage the SALT talks. The SALT talks started at the beginning of 1969. In those 2 years that have intervened, the Russians have doubled the ICBM capacity. In those 2 years, she has greatly strengthened her ABM system around Moscow. I think we need to play by the same rules, because unless we do, there will be a tendency to freeze the present situation, in which will put us at a permanent disadvantage, which means, if I can give you a striking example, an illustration, it would mean that in another year or two, if there were a Cuban missile crisis, it would be the United States, not the Soviet Union, who would have to back down.
Ms. King.
I looked it back to the economy. As a conservative, I think you said you cannot, or you have some reservations about government subsidizing industry and also about government providing or creating government paychecks. Then is the solution, or do you find the solution in unemployment, then in manipulation of the economy, and should people be supported until those kind of manipulations are successful?
First of all, I want to make it extremely clear that I don't believe that anybody who just plain can't find employment should be just allowed to rot in the streets. We've got the obligation as a society to see that someone who is incapable of working, either because of a physical defect or because the jobs are not there or because he absolutely has none of the minimum skills required for the job market, that it is society's obligation to take care of him. And I think the level of government better suited to do this is the state and local levels of government. I think that there's a point of diminishing returns as you reach towards Washington in order to help people who are located here in Sacramento rather than somewhere else. In terms of the government's ultimate responsibility, we are right now suffering through the results of lack of responsibility, through tremendous overspending at a time when our economy is working at full hilt. Once, if we can ever get the self-discipline to get things back in an orderly basis and maintain our money supply at a point where it is growing in relation to the growth in our real productivity, under those circumstances, we're going to get stability in such things as employment and so on, or at least a greater degree of stability. There are occasions, I'm sure, where government needs to step in, needs to provide training and things of that sort, but if we start subsidizing whole industries, we are going, among other things, to increase inefficiency.
There is a substantial segment of those on unemployment who don't need retraining, who have skills, who are equipped for a job, but the jobs just plain aren't there. And
My proposals in defense have taken care of your aerospace industry.
Pardon me?
I've taken care of Seattle and California and parts of New York with my renewed defense spend.
What about the rest of the economy?
Well, I wondered if, we have managed to, or our economy has been based on this continuing expansion in the past. Our problems now are partly due to you said overspending, but also partly due to this dependency on a continuing cycle of expansion. May that be part of what you're calling more responsible economic theories? Can we stop this expansion, or do we have to continue this expansion exist?
You're touching on an area which interests me greatly, and I don't know enough about it. Now, I suspect what would ultimately happen. First of all, there'll come a limit to the amount of gadgetry we want to add in a house. Whether we're there now or not, I just don't know. But people tend to want more convenient things. Now, you can talk about the essential conveniences and versus the frills. But we are moving towards a shorter work week. Maybe this is how we ultimately, if we get so efficient in terms of production, perhaps we get out of your cycle a little bit by just reducing the number of hours we work.
You think we may have to recognize at some time that there will be a percentage of the population without work and unable to work and no jobs available, and it's going to stay that way. I think maybe the problem with welfare.
But that percentage to begin with does increase, doesn't it? It increases as you have more people going to graduate school, and it increases as you have earlier retirements. So that the percentage of people who increase plus the contraction of the work week, which is something that's been going on over 150 years, actually harmonize with one another.
But at some point, you have to recognize that as government doesn't manufacture money, there is a balance that has to be achieved between where you can afford to stop working if the people who are left behind can't earn enough to support themselves and you.
Well, my question is, we always seem to, and both parties, react to welfare, I think, from the premise that ideally it should not exist. If things were functioning well, welfare would not exist, and they attack the problem from how to, get rid of it. And would
not
a
get
better
rid of
approach
it, but how to make
to
it achieve its true function. Nobody wants to see people trapped into a kind of endless dependency on welfare. Nobody wants to see welfare abused because, among other things, it cheats the people who really need it. I think that among the principal quarrels has been how to make the system work more effectively in two ways, so that the money that is taxed and spent for this need reaches the people in sufficient quantities who really need it. How does the system exclude the people that shouldn't be there in the first instance? And thirdly, how can we combine the welfare system with a job placement, a training, or whatever that will help people get off welfare into production? How do we provide those incentives? What I've been able to observe just chasing around New York State and talking to people who have to administer welfare, that one of the principal problems has been that Washington imposes the regulations telling local people how best to help local people, and that we have thrown in a complex of regulations that, number one, takes most of the time of the social worker, but number two, makes it impossible to handle things in a flexible, common sense manner.
Mr. Murphy?
What I'd like to ask you is, with the growing, let's say, sophistication of politics, and we're talking, speaking of the gross national product, spending and deficit, how does someone that wants to be informed politically of the things happening around him, but he is uneducated or he doesn't understand the numerous details of the different aspects of politics, how could he stay abreast? What could we do to
It's a difficult problem. Things tend to get so complicated, so complex, that no one can be an expert on everything, even in the Senate, when you've got staffs and so on to help you. I think you've got to seek out literature that discusses political problems and so on, and search out those magazines and journals and so on, which will give you both sides of the question. If you want to get a true understanding of what are the arguments pro and con.
Well, that's what I'm saying. What if this person, he doesn't have enough, let's say, common sense to search out this, you know, as you're forming a new party, just in your state, what would you do to make sure that more people would become involved, you know, and not just scraping off the top enough to get you elected and send you to the White House, but to really get people involved, you know, as young people say, you know, everyone should be involved from the time they know until the time they die in politics.
I've been in two campaigns now, plus my brother Bill's, and I've developed a tremendous confidence in the intuitive good sense of the voter, provided he's given the facts. And I personally feel that it is good politics to say what you mean, to give the reasons why you approve of this program or disapprove of that, and that'll be part of the educational policy. There will be an element of the population that doesn't follow politics close enough to be able to make an independent judgment, but at least that that individual will sooner or later say that this man or these groups of men do represent my general point of view. I do like the way they've been handling them, and then they will follow the lead of those individuals. But I believe that one of the problems we've had in this country is that to the extent that we start transferring responsibilities to bureaucrats who are not responsive to anybody, to the extent that we transfer the seat of bureaucracy from the city and state to Washington, to that extent the citizen starts getting a feeling of helplessness, a feeling that he really has no control over his own destiny, so what's the use? And I think the one way to start doing that is to start returning power from Washington to local areas, start dismantling a red tape. I don't think we're going to get there by reform. I think we've just got to abolish a lot of federal programs so that those responsibilities can be reassumed at levels of government that are closer to the people, and therefore where individuals can see how things operate.
Would you like to see the federal government get out of welfare, except in those states which are poorer than the national average?
Yeah.
Completely.
Yes. And as the ultimate goal, you can't do anything overnight once you've institutionalized something in the wrong way. But Senator Curtis has introduced legislation that will start you in that direction, a kind of a revenue-sharing approach to welfare, which would take the existing money being contributed by the federal government and just distribute it to the states on a formula basis, and not interfere with the manner the states handle it.
And has that bill gotten wide backing?
It has just been introduced in the last little while, so it hasn't had a chance to be studied and digested. I hope it'll get very wide backing.
Is it something that's likely to come to a vote this year?
I don't know. I somehow doubt it because you have the whole committee process, and it's going to be controversial, it's going to require a lot of hearings, and in the meantime, people are focusing on this family assistance program.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, members of the panel.
Printed copy of this program, send 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. That address again, Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina, 29205. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. This is PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service.